Merry Christmas. Welcome to worship today as we celebrate the fact that our Savior was born into this world to take on human flesh so that he could save us. We'll see the reasons that we have this morning to shout and sing for joy at what our Lord has done for us. The order of service is printed out in your service folder. It is also up on the screen. We'll begin by singing our opening hymn, hymn 354, O Come All Ye Faithful. Note that we'll stand for the singing of the last stanza.
Thank you.
Sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. The Lord has made his salvation known and revealed his righteousness to the nations. All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God. But who can endure the day of his coming? Who can stand when he appears? If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand? Restore us again, O God, our Savior, and put away your displeasure toward us. Show us your unfailing love, O Lord, and grant us your salvation. Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, because he has come and has redeemed his people. My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. When the time had fully come, God sent his Son, born of a woman, born under law, to redeem those under law, that we might receive the full rights of sons. The Word became flesh, made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. Glory to God in the highest. Let us pray. Almighty God, grant that the birth of your only Son in the flesh may set us free from our old bondage under the yoke of sin. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. Our first reading for this morning and also our sermon text is taken from Isaiah chapter 52, beginning with verse 7. How beautiful on the mountains are the feet of a herald who proclaims peace and preaches good news, who proclaims salvation, who says to Zion, your God is king. The voice of your watchmen, they lift up their voices together. They shout for joy, because with both eyes they will see it when the Lord returns to Zion. Break out, shout for joy together, you ruins of Jerusalem, because the Lord is comforting his people. He is redeeming Jerusalem. The Lord lays bare his holy arm before the eyes of all the nations, and all the ends of the earth will see the salvation from our God. The word of the Lord. We sing. Amen. Our second reading is taken from the letter to the Hebrews, chapter 1, beginning with verse 1. In the past, God spoke to our forefathers by the prophets at many times and in many ways. In these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, and through whom he made the universe. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact imprint of the divine nature. He sustains all things by his powerful word. After he had provided purification for sins, he took his seat at the right hand of the Majesty on high. The Son became as much superior to the angels as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. For to which of the angels did God ever say, "You are my Son, today I have begotten you"? And again, "I will be his Father, and he will be my Son." And again, when he brought his firstborn into the world, he said, "Let all God's angels worship him." About the angels, he says, "He makes his messengers winds and his ministers flaming fire." But about the Son, he says, "God, your throne is forever and ever, and the scepter of righteousness is the scepter of your kingdom. You have loved righteousness and hated wickedness. Therefore, God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of joy beyond your companions." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand for our gospel reading this morning. Christmas gospel is taken from John chapter 1, beginning with verse 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him everything was made, and without him not one thing was made that has been made. In him was life, and the life was the light of mankind. The light is shining in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as an eyewitness to testify about the light, so that everyone would believe through him. He was not the light, but he came to testify about the light. The real light that shines on everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not recognize him. He came to what was his own, yet his own people did not accept him. But to all who did receive him, to those who believe in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. They were born not of blood or of the desire of the flesh or of a husband's will, born of God. The Word became flesh and dwelled among us. We have seen his glory, the glory he has as the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth. The gospel of the Lord. Praise be to you, O Christ. Congregation may be seated as we invite forward the younger children for a devotion. Good morning, everyone. How are we doing today? Well, I got something in the bag here. Should I open it up, see what it is? Should I pull it out? What do you think this is going to be? Well, what is that? Preston? It's a tent. Anybody ever slept in a tent before? Yeah? It's kind of fun to sleep in a tent outside right now. Would you want to stay in a tent on a day like today?
No.
Why not?
Because
it's cold outside, right? And yeah, a tent is nice, usually though for the summer or for warmer weather, right? You wouldn't want to stay in a tent year-round. It's not a permanent home. It's more of a one you take down, put up. Some of you want to maybe you do camping or do it in your backyard. A tent isn't that kind of a dwelling. And yet, that's the word that we heard in our gospel reading this morning. It said, the word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. In the Greek, that's really to make a tent, that dwelling word, to set up a temporary place. And so the word is Jesus. And Jesus came into this world to make his dwelling here. Remember, he's born on Christmas. And he lives here for 33 years or so in this world, but then he goes back to heaven. But it's very important that he came here for that short time. Why did Jesus have to come here for that short time here on this earth? He had to take away our sins. He had to live a perfect life, never sin even once. He had to die on the cross to pay for our sins. He had to do that for us. So that, where do we get to go to someday? We get to go to our permanent home. This earth, we will live here for many years. 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100 years, whatever it might be for us. And yet that's a short term. That's a short time compared to what we're waiting for in heaven. Because when we get to go to heaven, we'll be there forever and spend our eternity with Jesus. So we're here today to celebrate the fact that Jesus came into this world to become like us, to take our place, so that someday we can join him in heaven someday. We'll talk more about that in our sermon this morning and as we sing our songs this morning. So let's fold our hands, bow our heads, and pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for sending your Son Jesus into this world to take on human flesh and become like us, to make his dwelling among us. Be with us as we live our lives in this world. Watch over us until the day that you take us home to heaven. Help us to go and tell others, like the shepherds, about what Jesus means to us so that they too can join us in heaven someday. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. You guys can walk back to your seats. We'll continue with hymn 358, singing the first four stanzas. Thank you. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. Your brothers and sisters in our Christ who has now come. One of the ways that we celebrate this time of year is to sing Christmas carols, sing Christmas hymns. We sang many of them last night at our service and also now this morning as well. But we sing at all of our church services. And singing, though, is even still a part of our secular world celebrations of this day. People like to sing Christmas carols. Even someone who doesn't like to sing still knows the words to many of these songs. Singing these songs may bring people together to give them that feeling of connectedness. It may bring back past memories of songs that were sung and the good memories attached to those. But singing these songs means so much more in our lives. We heard in our text from Isaiah this morning, he used the phrase twice, shout for joy. And as we look at these verses, we'll see why this morning we sing and shout for joy. First, as a herald, and second, as a messenger, as a watchman. So let's start this morning by talking about feet. How often do you think about your feet? Maybe you don't think about, maybe you think about them a lot, maybe not so much. We use our feet to stand and walk and run. Maybe you think about your feet more, though, when they're hurting and you're not able to stand and walk and run. We don't often see each other's feet here, especially in Minnesota in the winter. We like to keep them covered up. We don't walk up to someone and meet them, and the first thing we do is look at their feet. Our standards of beauty are not based on feet, as if it was love at first sight once I saw their feet. And yet, Isaiah talks about beautiful feet in our text for this morning. How beautiful on the mountain are the feet of a herald. Of course, it wasn't so much the feet themselves and what they looked like. It was what those feet were doing, and they were bringing a herald, bringing a messenger with a message to share. One who proclaims peace and preaches good news, who proclaims salvation, who says to Zion, your God is king. In Isaiah's day, of course, there were no phone calls or text messages or emails to be able to share news. Rather, you waited on a herald, a messenger, to come and bring news. News of peace when a war was finally over. News of rescue and a salvation when a king was coming to rescue you, to defeat your enemies. Verse 9 makes this even more specific for Isaiah's audience. Break out, shout for joy together, you ruins of Jerusalem, because the Lord is comforting his people. He is redeeming Jerusalem. As often with Isaiah's prophecies, he's talking about multiple things here. The first is in 100 years in the future, Jerusalem would be turned to ruins, people carried off to exile. And so Isaiah is prophesying that even though you will be gone, you will be coming back. The Lord will return. The king will return and bring his people back to Jerusalem. But Isaiah is also prophesying of something much more here. Prophesying of the coming Messiah, the one who would comfort his people by redeeming his people, by buying them back from sin, death, and the devil. This would be the best news for any herald to bring and a true reason to shout for joy. So we too this morning shout for joy because of that baby born in Bethlehem. The incarnation, God taking on human flesh, will always remain a mystery to our understanding. And yet it is precisely what we need. We were born into this world in spiritual ruins, born with a sinful nature inherited from our parents, daily committing actual sins in our lives. We were held captive by the devil and deserved a permanent and eternal exile from God in the fires of hell. Yet Jesus came to comfort us and redeem us, to buy us back. He lived a perfect life, gifting us his righteousness. He died a horrible death to take away the punishment for our sins that we deserve. He conquered death so that someday we too will rise from the dead to an eternal life in heaven. He defeated the devil so that we no longer belong to him, but we belong to our God and are his children. We have perfect peace with God. There is no greater news that we could ever hear in our lives, no greater gift that we could ever receive. This is reason to shout for joy today and every day. And so we too can be heralds with beautiful feet in a world that still largely celebrates Christmas, even if they're only celebrating it as a time for family, or a time for presents, or a time off of work or school. As heralds, we can share the real reason for celebration on this day. Our God is our King, and their King as well. There are also many people today who don't have reasons to celebrate, whether they're missing family, or missing gifts, or missing time off. They especially need to hear the comfort that our Savior has brought. He loves them too, and has redeemed them, and will give them the greatest gift they could ever hope for. They too can still shout for joy, even in their sadness, because our God is our King. Isaiah described another role in verse 8. The voice of your watchmen, they lift up their voices. Together they shout for joy, because with both eyes they will see it when the Lord returns to Zion. Like a herald, a watchman was an important job in Isaiah's day. There was no radar, no satellite feeds to let someone know who was coming, whether they were friend or foe. The watchmen would stand on the walls to look out and see who was coming, to announce who was coming. In this case, they were waiting for that king to return. Again, in that intermediate fulfillment, God would be bringing the people back from exile, bringing them home safely to Jerusalem. Verse 10 explains how this would happen. The Lord lays bare his holy arm before the eyes of all nations, and all the ends of the earth will see the salvation from our God. In the short term, God had used the Babylonian Empire to wipe out Jerusalem, but now he would wipe out the Babylonians with the Persian Empire and use King Cyrus to bring his people back to Jerusalem, directing world history in that way, showing he had the power and control. But ultimately, these prophecies go far beyond that time frame. The Messiah would come to display his almighty power and defeat sin, death, and the devil for all people of all time. Christ will come on the last day and lay bare his mighty arm as he shows to the ends of the earth that he is judge and king. And so we stand as watchmen. We wait with eager expectation for our King to return. Because we live in a world that is falling apart and not getting better. We live our lives each day with suffering that sometimes doesn't seem to end. We are waiting for our Lord to return because he will bring us rescue from this world. He will come to end our suffering. As watchmen, we watch not just for ourselves, but for those around us. We want to give others the warning of the danger that is coming if they do not repent of their sins. And we want to share with them the reason that we have for hope. We want them to join us in shouting for joy when our King returns. Because on that day, he will lay bare his holy arm and we will see that salvation that is waiting for us as we enter into that eternal home of heaven. So on this Christmas day, as we join again to sing all our favorite Christmas songs, it is much more than singing these tunes. It is the meaning behind those words. We shout for joy as heralds and watchmen, because our King has come. We celebrate Christmas each year, not just as some event from the past, but as a present event and a future event. Christ has come, and our sins are forgiven, and he gives us comfort for our sufferings right now. Christ will come in the end to end all of our sufferings and bring us to our home in heaven. So break out and shout for joy together, because our God is our King. Amen. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. We join to sing hymn 361. Please stand as we join to pray. Eternal Father, we give you thanks and praise on this holy day for sending your one and only Son to share our humanity, carry our guilt, and become for us the perfect Lamb who takes away the sin of the world. Lord, we praise you. Keep our faith in your Son alive and strong. Nourish us with your word and sacraments, and by your Holy Spirit, give us strength to overcome Satan's power and empty promises. Help us to withstand the temptations of the world and our sinful nature that they put on our path. Give us faith and courage. Remember ministers of the gospel throughout the world who on this day are proclaiming that a Savior has been born. We especially commend to your care the missionaries we have called as members of the Wisconsin Synod. Since they cannot enjoy the fellowship of their extended families this Christmas, grant to them the inner joy that comes with service in your kingdom. Protect all those who proclaim the gospel in our place. Fill us with kindness and arouse us to do good to all people, especially those who are less fortunate than we. Bring your healing to those who are sick or diseased in body or mind, and comfort those who are mourning the death of someone they love. We especially pray for brothers and sisters who are setting aside their celebration today to care for the sick and stand at the side of the dying. Sustain those who endure the troubles of life. Be a source of strength to all your people, and fill them with your power and peace. If any are among us today who have lost the true meaning of this festival, let them rediscover the joy that comes from Christ alone. Let your peace reign in the hearts of all. Father, we bring these prayers before you this Christmas and always, confident that you will hear and answer them. For it was your only Son who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly good and right that we should at all times and in all places give you thanks, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whose wonderful and mysterious birth you have opened our eyes to the glory of your grace, and renewed in our hearts the fervor of your love. Therefore, with all the saints on earth and hosts of heaven, we praise your holy name and join their glorious song. Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. Congregation may be seated. At this time, we invite forward to the Lord's table those who are members of this congregation and others in our Wisconsin Standard Fellowship. Come, for all things are now ready. Please stand as we join to sing. Now sing we now rejoice, now raise to heaven our voice, he from whom joy streameth for in a manger lies. Not so brightly beameth the sun in yonder skies. Thou my Savior art, Thou my Savior art. We give you thanks, O Lord, for the foretaste of the heavenly banquet that you have given us to eat and to drink in this sacrament. Through this gift, you have fed our faith, nourished our hope, and strengthened our love. By your Spirit, help us to live as your holy people until the day when you will receive us as your guests at the wedding supper of the Lamb, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. May he who by his incarnation gathered things earthly and heavenly into one, fill us with such joy that comes with the knowledge of the forgiveness of sins and the hope of eternal life. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Good morning, once again, welcome, special welcome to our guests and visitors joining us here in worship, joining us online as well. If you haven't had a chance yet, please sign the friendship registers located in each pew, the online connection card as well. Thank you to all our musicians here this morning that added to our service, especially Maria and all the things that she's done to add to our service this morning. As far as announcements, next weekend, we have that one service at 9 o'clock again on Sunday morning, New Year's Day, one service at 9. Following that, the YPS will meet to take down some of the decorations here in church. If you did order the flowers, the poinsettias, you're welcome to come up after the service and take them home. They should all be marked with your name on it if you did order it that way. As you leave this morning, please greet those around you, and may God continue to bless you as you celebrate the birth of our Savior to this world.
Thank you.